Welcome to this week's Beyond Bitcoin Hangout. These hangouts are brought to you by the Beyond Bitcoin crew. We encourage everyone to freely share these recordings and to help spread the knowledge and benefits of our DePost 2.0 blockchain technology that we all call BitShares. While listening to this recording, please feel free to visit our website, beyondbitcoin.org, and be sure to stay tuned in for some additional information at the end of the recording. As always, we would like to say thank you, and we appreciate your support. So please continue to vote for our delegate or worker contract so we may continue providing these valuable services to our community members. So once again, welcome, and please enjoy this week's Hangout.
Welcome, everybody, to another Beyond Bitcoin Hangout. We're joined every week by Byte Master from Cryptonomics and, of course, Chief Developer of BitShares to provide project updates, give his opinions on various issues going on in the ecosystem that is BitShares, and then we open up to community questions. Byte Master, would you like to get started with the project update for the week?
It's been another exciting week in the realm of BitShares. We've had several first events this week. The committee members acted without my involvement and made a decision and got a change to the fees pushed through to the blockchain. I was very happy to see the community self-organize to review those decisions and publish and cause them to take effect, all without my influence. That's good for BitShares. That's good for me, and overall, I was very pleased with that. There were many lessons learned from the process. For one, the committee members need a little bit more transparent, offer a little bit more time for discussion between making their decision and having it apply, and should probably seek feedback in the form of a proposal prior to actually saying that's what's going to happen. But everyone's got to learn. We got to start somewhere. We will refine this process, refine the layers of communication. From my perspective, I'm just happy that more people will experience what it's like to be in my shoes of trying to make decisions quickly, having someone hate you regardless of what you decide. It's nice to spread that around a little bit. It's quite the burden. But overall, I think it's a step in the right direction. It's proving things are decentralized. I don't have the stake necessary, either directly or indirectly, to unilaterally push anything through anymore. Voting for both witnesses and committee members has aggregated to totals of several hundred BitShares, several hundred million BitShares, which is beyond what I have direct influence over. So I no longer have 51%. So from here on out, it is going to require community consensus gathering and effort from people like the proxy voters. Other things this week, we've come up with a process for doing worker proposals. On GitHub, we have a special tag on various issues that are worker proposals, where we outline what the proposal is in relatively fine-grained detail. And then you can discuss the issue right there on GitHub. And if you install ZenHub, which is a extra Chrome extension, actually get some voting and other feedback on the various worker proposals off-chain. This week, we had the first worker proposal get created by Bunker Chain Labs and voted in by 230 million BitShares. This is a worker proposal to refund the create order fee if it's canceled before being partially filled. That seemed to have universal acceptance across the board. I don't know of anyone who was against it, so that has been accepted and work has begun to implement that feature as a hard fork. I'd like to thank Bunker Chain Labs for overseeing the execution creation of the worker and everyone who is voting for it and the overall process. This is a learning experience both on how to communicate and discuss and define the worker proposals, as well as how to assure quality assurance, make sure that people get paid, and so on and so forth. I'm very pleased to see how things are evolving on that particular front. I guess that's the majority of the technological updates. The only other update, I posted something yesterday designed to encourage everyone to take perspective or get, you know, step back and remember why we are here or why you are here. You know, my reasons may be different than some of yours, but regardless of your reasons, it never hurts to step back, assess the situation, and make sure that we don't get caught up in the day-to-day details and worries, and instead can focus on what really matters to us in life. And with respect to BitShares, I'm very interested in finding free markets for securing life, liberty, and property. That's the purpose. The reason why I'm here and a lot of you are here is because we want to change the world and make it a better place. We want to provide tools that make people financially independent, protect from having their accounts seized or other forms of financial enslavement. Those are things that BitShares is here for, and it solves some of the problems that we need in a free market, like the ability to trade and establish prices. And so the exchange is a critical part of that. But the exchange is not the end game. It's always good to remember that. And the other thing to remember is if people are motivated by why we are doing it, that makes it easier to both attract people and keep people, which is what we're ultimately trying to do. If all you're trying to do is trade one cryptocurrency for another, and that's the end goal, you're going to go where it's the cheapest, you're going to go where it's the easiest, and where it's the fastest. But if you have a higher goal of, well, I don't want to just exchange it, I want to do so in a system that is protecting my freedom, has high degrees of integrity in terms of structure, all the philosophy, all the reasons why we are doing it, I want to support those reasons. And you come to BitShares, even if it's slightly more expensive or slightly less convenient. So if we focus on the why, then we'll attract users, we'll keep users, and people will use it even if there are some rough edges. That's not a reason to not work on improving those rough edges. That's what we always want to do. But this is a marathon. This is not a sprint. BitShares will be successful over 10 years, not 10 months. And if we keep the proper long-term perspective and we keep improving it day in and day out and we focus on the why we are doing all these improvements, then it doesn't matter if mainstream doesn't adopt us. We will be gaining a strong and loyal following that will gradually grow. Going straight for mainstream adoption usually means compromising principles and values, and some people just aren't ready for everything. But if you go after a niche market, niche markets are where all ideas have to start. You know, the Tesla car, they go after that niche of high-end where people are willing to pay the most for it, because they can then take the profits they earn from there to fund into research and development, and then gradually bring the cost down to approach wider. Going wide too early, you're just going, it's just not ready. Those are just some thoughts. You know, I'm not trying to push my view on anyone else. I'm just trying to share what motivates me, and that this is not something that we should give up on if the price is down or if user adoption is slow. It just helps calibrate us so that we can actually see the steady, consistent progress in a more objective and less scary light. So I like to just throw that out there and then open the floor to questions.
Well, I'll say one thing before we get started here. You're talking about this reminds me of a man named Viktor Frankl, who I read some books by a while back when I was studying psychology stuff. And Viktor Frankl was a mental health doctor. He dealt with a lot of stuff during Nazi Germany and was apparently taken to concentration camps. And there was a saying from his book that I will never forget. He said that if a man can figure out why to live, they can bear almost any how. And he was talking about it in the context of surviving through the hard times and realizing that if people had a why to keep on going, then it really didn't matter so much what they actually endured. They could handle it. And it's just kind of an interesting thing to bring up right now, because I remember reading that and thinking about, you know, it truly comes down to our choice on if it gets hard, are we going to walk away or are we going to keep trucking and keep banging our head against the problems and finding solutions? So, yeah, I think a lot of us are here for the long term, but, you know, it doesn't mean that sometimes it doesn't get hard. So that's kind of why we're all here, and we all have to kind of also be a community, right, and try to help one another through those hard times. But it looks like everything is starting to – it's cool that the committee proposal is working. The worker proposal for Bunker Labs has been voted in. One question I wanted to ask you real quick, and I don't know where you stand on this, in terms of worker proposals to pay for something like, let's say you are invited to a conference to speak. Does Cryptonomics have to, you know, is Cryptonomics going to have money to pay for that, or would it be helpful if BitShares holders could help to pay for it through something like a worker proposal for you to travel to some of these big conferences?
It would certainly be helpful if we got compensated for it. We have to do careful calculations on everything we do. Now, we've been invited to speak at many conferences, but the cost of traveling is, it's a week worth of lost time and effort that we could have worked on other billable activities. And so if we go promoting BitShares, things like that, that's a direct expense that is not reimbursed through things like referral income as a result of that trip. So it's a really tough decision, because we're talking about thousands of dollars of worth of opportunity costs associated with going to conferences and the like. And we want to promote BitShares and make it happen. So I've been hesitant to ask for worker proposals of the like, but if someone else wanted me to go to something that I didn't feel like funding out of my own pocket, then I would certainly wouldn't turn that down if there was significant in that. One of the things that is both bad is having everything be nickel and dimed, or charging the blockchain for everything. Cryptonomics is clearly benefiting, at least it has the appearance of benefiting significantly from the worker proposals, because we're the single biggest provider of worker proposals and there are not many other options. So we are not trying to overcharge or do anything else. We're just trying to say, well, what are our opportunity costs? What are our time and the like? But I'm thinking off the top of my head here, but I don't want people to get the idea that I'm not willing to do anything for BitShares unless I get paid, because the intent BitShares without getting paid on, you know, every day. This week there was a bug. We're fixing that in the wallet and as well as the blockchain, making sure everyone's whole. All that is work we're doing without asking for a worker proposal to resolve it at the cost of thousands of dollars in our time and opportunity cost, as well as actual people I have to pay to realize these fixes. So I just want to let everyone know, Cryptonomics is investing money aside from the worker proposals in improving BitShares. But when we put prices on the various worker proposals, part of it is to help everyone else prioritize. If there isn't a price associated with it, we don't have an estimate of the complexity and how it's going to impact schedule. So by putting it helps prioritize, it helps everyone in the community know this is the level of technical effort involved with something, and then people can value it. The downside to having those prices out there is sticker shock. You know, a lot of people make less than $50,000 a year, and they see a worker proposal to do something that on the surface looks relatively simple as equal to a whole year. Like, that person, Cryptonomics and Bikemaster, are ripping the blockchain off, and they're being selfish. What's going on here? It's just, it's a real double-edged sword. It's great transparency, but not everyone has a perspective to know what these things actually cost to do. And so I'm doing my best in trying to learn there, but it's a very, very long answer to say, yes, I think having worker proposals to fund travel to promote at conferences might be justified.
I'm curious about the thread that you started yesterday, which I really enjoyed reading and participating in. One of the things that I'm curious about is this thrust of yours to start that thread makes me believe that there's some source of revenue. You don't seem to be as concerned about revenue, because in the times past, we have really been so worried about revenue and paying the team, et cetera, but that seems to be gone now. I mean, you wouldn't be saying these things if you were really overly worried about the source of income to the team, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm curious where this source of income is coming from. I mean, there's so many balls in the air. I'm sure there's plenty of good reasons for it, but I'm just curious what that is.
Sure. We've been working with many private things like music and even some other BitShares-related companies have been hiring us to do things like custom wallets for them, or things for the Muse chain or private chains. So sorry for repeating myself there, but we've got customers that are currently paying and actively paying that can more than saturate all of our available time. And so the other reason why we worker proposals are is because we can make that money somewhere else, and we have customers there, and we have to turn down jobs right now because we're trying to hire. So I'll just let everyone know, if you know how to do React.js or great at JavaScript and you're looking for a job, we are actually hiring because we've got a lot of work coming our way that we've already received. So that's very good. A lot of this work is improving BitShares, providing infrastructure for BitShares. But you know, it's the market, and we're trying to balance out our time. What we try to do is bill enough so that we can pay our people to do the jobs, plus earn enough profit to do research and development and pay people to improve our core technologies and the like. So I hope that answers your question.
I have a question about the why. And I'd kind of like to take the other side, alternative to the collapsing regular work. And I'd like to, Facebook and Twitter, they may have gone after a niche market in the beginning, but the niche market was just simply early adopters. It wasn't libertarians or a particular philosophy. I'm as libertarian as anyone here. In fact, How I Found Freedom in an Unfree World is one of my favorite books, and I think I found a PDF version I'll post to the forum here. But anyway, I think we could go for success in 10 months, and it's by using a why for the common man that everyone says, oh, we've discussed gambling in the past. And I say, well, add to it. One is a jackpot of user-issued assets, which are not considered money, which should take care of a lot of the legal framework. And the other is jackpots and rewards that go to multi-sig accounts rather than an individual. Again, protecting individuals from having received a jackpot and things of that nature. So with that kind of why, the interested, but they wouldn't necessarily take over BitShares with their voting, because they probably wouldn't vote. So I'd like your comments on that. Thank you.
I agree with you that gambling is a very powerful why for the average man. And I think by asking, you know, long-term perspective, you know, would cause us to lose favor with the banks. But if our long-term goal is to be independent of the banks, maybe we should reconsider gambling-related activities, because if we're so worried about being friendly, but like we said, that also caused us to lose a lot of Chinese users. So there's lots of trade-offs in all of these things, and I'm not trying to say that I'm supporting gambling on the blockchain. I'm just saying that I have a very good point that being fun is a profitable thing that people can understand today, and then people can also get behind the why of either financial independence or just sticking it to the man. There's lots of people that want to stick it to the man, whoever the man is.
It's interesting because we, doing the ShareBits thing, we've been talking about BitShares and kind of focusing on it from a different light, from kind of a different angle, where BitShares is kickstarting the sharing economy. And that is a good way, is in terms of a politically sound way of saying, you know, kind of sticking it to the man, because a P2P sharing economy really does stick it to the man. But at the same time, it wraps it in an envelope of like a big heart, and it makes it pretty hard to attack it, because it's kind of like it would be like attacking the Red Cross, you know, or something to that effect, like, because it's doing something good and it's opening up this P2P economy, right? So we've been focusing on it from that standpoint. What? Sorry.
Yeah, on the P2P economy, I have been talking to people with business plans similar to Uber in various different areas, and potentially putting that on the blockchain itself, potentially BitShares. So, you know, there are people that are interested in investing money outside of worker proposals to build a hybrid service that uses the blockchain for doing the database and the operations, but they control their own custom Uber-like web portal. So there's this partnership between the blockchain and that. So all the blockchain would have to do is approve the hard fork to enable the features they need. They'd fund all the work. It shares benefits, and now people have the why. That type of business relationship, those are the type of conversations I'm having with people behind the scenes and trying to raise money for.
And this is actually one of the reasons, just to go back real quick, to the reason why I brought up paying for travel expenses, is because NXT has a number of their community members who are now being paid to kind of advocate in public and, you know, show up for conferences in their local areas and various things like that. And I thought it was really cool because Ingenesis has invited you guys to join up at one of their conferences as well. And I don't know if you guys are familiar, but Dan Robles, aka Ingenesis, has a project that is going to be looking into blockchain technology for the NSPE, which is the National Society of Professional Engineers. And there's 100,000+, if I'm getting this correct, engineers who would be potentially tapped to look into and utilize blockchain technology for various tasks. And I find myself thinking that even if we had to pay $10,000 for travel expenses, if that connected you guys up with people like that, that's a really big deal. You know, so these little things, I don't want to overlook them, but at the same time, I don't want to press on it too much. But there
Can I say something?
Yes, please.
So I totally get where you guys are coming from, and you know, like even middle roads we go with. I think we could you can't send somebody there, but if you know somebody locally in San Francisco who you think can adequately represent you, maybe we'll find a place for them. Or I could speak with Dan for a while and we can get the ideas out on the table. So, you know, there's a lot of things we can do, but it's gonna take a much less investment on your time. And then, you know, time doing, I have, these are the throwing at this thing. I can't go, I can't, you know, I'm not, you know, some people, I can't throw this stuff at it, but it's not guaranteed either. And we're all doing it for free too. So there's in the middle road, I think there's a lot of room to play in, you know, how we can come up with strategies to be present without being expensive.
You know, that's actually why Mumble came together, because that's precisely what we were doing, was trying to make a low cost conference center tool that enabled people to all get together and from geographically distant locations and merge into a conference right here, right now, where you have a press pass and you can all record and ask questions. That's pretty much the model that we're taking. So, you know, there's a lot of technology, Google Hangouts and other various things. So, yeah, you're right. It's a good point, and it's also a good point to bring up, because as we become more quote-unquote decentralized, we're going to need more people standing up and doing those things. So I'm glad that opening it up has gotten people focusing on solutions.
But there are other things that we're not doing well. Like we need customer support for using the tools that are available and stuff like that. How can we kind of, you know, really fill in that center with things like customer support to help us understand how to use the technology and then move on with it? Then we'll find the funding. I mean, it's just sort of a chicken and egg thing, but we got the same chicken and egg you guys have.
The problem is that all these things are good. There's a fixed budget, and now it's just about prioritizing, right? And one of the things we've realized is, at least traveling to Bitcoin conferences, you got the same speakers at almost all the conferences. I already know or have talked most of them, or could reach out on the phone and call them personally at any time when I have the message and everything I need to reach them. So the number of new contacts made at any given conference is relatively small. And it's also fleeting. You spend all that money, you either succeed or fail, and there's no residual product that's continuing to benefit. You could take the money that you would spend on a conference and pay for a high quality animated video that explains something, you know, a whiteboard, you know, introduction to BitShares, or, you know, basically something that gives a 5-minute pitch that can be played and reused over and over and over again and reach 1,000 the number of people, versus giving that same 5-minute pitch as part of a panel in a conference and only reaching the people that were there that day and having to be, you know, off the cuff or not as polished as something that could go viral. So generally speaking, I prefer to spend our time and money on producing marketing material like videos rather than conferences, because we can reach out to the people we need to reach out to, and going to a conference is less effective. It's more effective early on, and we did a lot of traveling early on. If it wasn't for the early conferences that we went to, BitShares wouldn't be where it is today, because it was through those conferences that I actually got to meet a lot of you, that we got some of the major investors, some of the whales that are still supporting the project today at those conferences, and would not have met if I hadn't gone to those conferences. People like Max and people who are doing a lot of the business development work with us, I would not have met without going to those conferences. So conferences have been extremely valuable in the past, but they get diminishing returns. And they might be valuable again in the future, but it's always a trade-off between producing long-term material that can then reach out to K people, or paying to go to the conference and reaching people one shot. So,
well, the conferences, you know, they pretty much say, are you in the game or not? I could speak at TED or corner, walk it out in the street corner and get nickels. So the conferences are really important, but, you know, for people like us, we're out here trying to engage with BitShares. We're trying dearly to use the product and the platform, but we can't find anybody. We don't know where anybody is, or we're having a hard time, interacting, because there's not enough people who speak for the program are, who can't speak for the program, are just so busy. You know, we get that, but we want to. You know, I just don't see a direct path to do that.
It is very tough. We need lots of evangelists out there to promote and to represent us at the. These are trade-offs, and I'm trying to describe some of the characteristics, and it's clearly not the full picture, because I clearly recognize the hard to quantify benefits of being perceived in the game just because you showed up. It shows up, say, oh, you didn't show up, you're not engaged anymore. And it might just be a part of the cost of doing business. There's a time and place for everything, and it's just not open and shut case that going to a conference is definitely worth it. But it's clearly good. It's just, is it the highest good?
A question that's kind of in line with this is from Fox, and he says, how important is academia to the future? And this has been something that was brought up by Charles Hoskins in our forums at one point in time. What are your thoughts on it?
I think academia has a role. It gives the appearance of legitimacy and rigor to something. And there's a certain segment of the population, the people who don't know how to think for themselves, who rely instead on academic credentials as ways of validating concepts. So does it have a role in cryptocurrency? It does. There's a lot of research and projects and proof of concepts that come out of academia, particularly when it comes to new cryptographic algorithms. I can tell you my strong suit is not the elliptic curve cryptography that's powering all this. I can use the tools other people have come up with and the math they've put together once they've reduced it to code. I can use it. But academia certainly has a role in providing the innovative cryptographic primitives of the system. So, you know, my personal opinions on academia, you know, it's not, I don't have a lot of respect for it in a certain light. I recognize that other people do have respect for it, and that I just wish the papers that academia published were more accessible, that people who are relatively intelligent like myself should be able to read the paper and actually get something out of it. And 99 times out of 100, the papers I read are worthless at actually helping me understand something new. I get more useful information from blogs like Vitalik produces. He does a really good job of taking complex subjects and explaining it in a way that I can understand. If more academic papers were written like the blogs Vitalik puts out, it would be helpful. But even Vitalik in his writing can quickly get into abstract math representations of things. That's my academia, is they write it all formal, they draw some conclusions, it's difficult to follow, and it's usually there's some faulty assumptions or some unstated stuff buried there, but then other people build on top of it, and it's just a mess. But that's just my opinion on academia. It certainly has a role because other people value it. It's like people, I value the dollar because other people value the dollar, even though I think it's crap.
So there's better ways, in your opinion?
Yes.
I had a few technical questions. One, the account has currently no vesting balances. A bunch of accounts have their refer set to the committee account, but the refer percent is, and then also the committee account has a lot of people using it as a proxy, and I'm wondering why that would happen, and I don't see how the committee account makes a proxy.
Challenges is miscommunication between the C++ team and the JavaScript web team. Early on, we had the committee account, which is just account zero, indicate proxy to self. And then later we added a special only means wealth. And somewhere along the lines, things got crossed, and a lot of accounts are set to use the committee account as their proxy. In reality, what they're trying to express is that they want to vote for themselves. Anyone who goes and uses a recent version of the wallet and sets the proxy or votes for someone will change it to be something meaningful. In the meantime, committee members aren't actually voting for anyone, and so having them default to is basically I'm not voting for anyone setting. As far as the vesting balance on the committee account, I believe the decision was made those funds would just be burned for the committee account rather than accumulating in the vested balance for the committee account. So anything that existing users of BitShares at the time we upgraded, their referrer got set to the committee account, and any referral fees then went to the network rather than to someone like Cryptonomics.
Okay, are kilobytes scaled just like all the others?
Sorry, say that again?
The fees per kilobyte parameter in the fee schedule, does that get scaled as well?
That's the intent. I am actually contemplating removing the fee per kilobyte or setting it to zero just to have simplified pricing.
Well, isn't it useful to keep spam out, and especially considering that storage on the blockchain is permanent? Isn't there kind of a ongoing infinite cost associated with storing large blobs?
Yes, but our fees are high enough that even if you maxed out what the transaction will support, you more than cover those costs. So the only thing it's affecting is our margins on large transactions. Big memos would have a lower margin than transactions with no memos, but they'd be the same price. So it's simplified pricing. If you don't use it, then it's a win for the network if you do use it.
And then kind of a logistical question about with the worker proposals, you know, what happens if due to some voting issues her proposal drops out of rank for a day? So your guys' first worker proposal was 40 days. What if one of those is missed? What does that mean?
That's partially why the worker proposal is for more money than we think is necessary. So if we drop out a day or two, it's not an issue. And worst case scenario, there would just be a follow-up worker proposal where people have to honor the original one. But we'll come to that if it becomes an issue.
Cool. And just one last question. What is the assert operation?
The assert operation allows you to check certain properties of the blockchain state, like account, your account name and account ID are what you think they are. It's a way of checking your assumptions, and all those assumptions must be in order for the transfer to take effect. It's designed to be so that if you want to assert some market condition for the transfer, you can. So it's basically just a, this must be, or the entire transaction will be invalidated. So it's designed to be used in combination with other operations.
Cool, got it.
I want to follow up on Roadscape's questions about the details of the API. You know, there are people out there like Roadscape that would probably like to implement some things in BitShares, but they don't have that information necessary for these nuances that are discovered as you start coding a project or coding an interface to do something. What type of, this also segues into the issue of accountability or visibility, transparency with regard to keeping track of progress on various efforts that are underway right now. I think Jacob has done a fantastic job of highlighting some of those things for the GUI, and I'm just wondering, across the board, there's lots of different efforts that are underway, like documentation, for example. How can we keep track of where those are and know when we've come to completion?
You never can have enough enough documentation. So the concept of coming to completion, particularly
agree,
with a moving target.
It's a matter of setting a milestone. You know, obviously, there's everything can always be continued on in software, but if you set a goal and say this goal has been reached, then you can set other goals. But that's a matter of how you plan the progress of moving along, and reaching a milestone is completion of that milestone.
Yeah. So it's hard to get coverage of test of documentation. How do you measure how much you need? I don't even know, could enumerate everything that needs to be documented. But we can do some measures, like, you know, what percentage of the methods and parameters are documented. Doxygen can generate warnings on, here's all the things that haven't been defined. And so when it comes to the code, we can get some metric of coverage. And I think it would be good to try to improve that. When it comes to more abstract stuff like the design, I want to create a tutorial on how to create custom operations and stuff for Graphene. That's on my to-do list. So there's that. I'm welcome to any suggestions on, you know, how to measure. If you can tell me what's not there, then that can give me a checklist of things to go answer. And when people ask questions, well, okay, we can. Part of it might just be to, as people ask questions, keep a backlog and make sure all those questions aren't just answered for them, but they get incorporated into their proper place in the documentation. So perhaps the right thing to do is, if you ask it, it's not answered until you have a link to the documentation that answers it. That's one thing we can do there. Got a question on various software and things that we are contemplating. Actually taken this action yet. We're contemplating putting Graphene out under the GPL license, as well as the UI interface under the GPL license. What are your initial thoughts on that?
I mean, the main concern there would be just competitive advantage, correct?
Yes. It basically means that if you're doing a public blockchain and you make all your code available under GPL, then you'll be fine. But if you try to do private blockchains, then GPL doesn't work as well for you.
My concern would be fragmenting.
When you say the GUI as well, are you referring to the server side, what's it called?
Yes. We're talking about making everything needed to become Open Ledger GPL, except the deposit withdrawal bot for that Blocktrades is providing us.
Yeah, maybe a path towards it, and dedicate to give a few months to the current implementers as a competitive advantage to them.
So the reason why banks and other companies don't use GPL libraries is because they don't want to open source their changes. Anyone who's worked at a big company knows that if it's not BSD licensed or MIT licensed, you almost can't touch it unless you are just using it as is, as a binary form. But if you're going to actually write code against it, it's, you know, pretty much taboo for developers to integrate that code into their own custom projects.
Although they can always go to the maintainers and get a custom license, right?
Yes. So it'd be a dual license model where Cryptonomics would still make money from people who want to have a non-GPL license. It doesn't restrict our ability to license it under any terms we want, but it would give BitShares the ability to honestly claim that it's open source. Having the little restriction of it's open source so long as you use it with BitShares leaves a bad taste in a lot of people's mouths, and I think it would be a marketing move for BitShares. So BitShares gets the effect of being able to claim open source. The downside is other blockchains that are okay with being open source and GPL could use the code, but of course BitShares would be free to also incorporate the work they do. So, and we could leave it also licensed BSD terms for use with BitShares. The problem with having all these different licenses out there, every different contributor, if you pull project from other code from other projects, it's not cut and dry of what can be incorporated, right? If the GPL version of BitShares uses GPL code from Muse, then the BSD licensed version of BitShares wouldn't be able to use that code. And so they basically fork out everyone who is using BitShares under BSD. So there's licensing is a real mess. I was just interested in community feedback of GPL.
I'm particularly interested in having the web wallet be open source. I think that would help BitShares grow and then maybe grow a network effect through more open web wallet and then later on open up the core. I don't know.
Licenses are a funny thing. They're almost never enforced or expensive to enforce, but no legitimate company wants to go flouting a license because it's bad PR. You put the license there with some general terms of how you can use it, and most people will just follow those things. Even though they could get away with stealing it, they won't. It's just not professional.
So essentially any potential competition that we would have with this would be from other roots type communities that wanted to launch a DPoS 2.0 or graphene blockchain and not from large existing entrenched companies.
It depends. If a large existing entrenched company wants to have a public blockchain with open source GPL code and they're fine with releasing all their code, that's fine. So it could result in large companies backing an open protocol that's GPL based. So the question we have to ask as a community is would that be good or bad? It might be, I think there is so much involved in bootstrapping a community, in using code, in building off of what someone else has built, that I think people tend to be friendly and cooperative rather than be, I'm going to take your code and then smash you.
Doesn't this also come back to our first principles of moving the freedom ball forward? And GPL is definitely a more freedom-oriented approach than the more proprietary-oriented MIT and BSD licenses.
I will disagree with you on that. But using licenses in general to protect intellectual property, which is illegitimate, is completely dependent upon the state, and all of it suppresses free speech.
Well, that's a good point.
So the reason for using licenses is solely to have everyone, to manipulate the people who believe in it, right? You know, everyone believes in some god, and you tell them that this is wrong, they're going to obey you, even if you know that god's, you know, just an
idol. You have a cleaner perspective on it. I was just basically contrasting the two licenses, but I think your perspective on it is a lot cleaner.
Lucky Bit brings up a good question, though. He says that's fine and dandy basically for the USA, but what about in China where licenses don't matter? And he says here, all the competition would have to do is start the business in China, and then they can use all the code, but for US businesses.
Like I said earlier, the purpose of these licenses is to dissuade honest men, and it's not to protect against dishonest individuals. And the licenses are a right that we have to claim that's granted to us by the government, but without the government, we would actually have no right to claim the IP in the first place. Bottom line is, in China, they're more free than in the US because China doesn't enforce the copyright. Great. China. In the US, people are less free. And so on and so forth. But I think that from a PR perspective, GPL has a very open, everyone contributing back mentality to it. that still allows Cryptonomics to make money through private blockchains with corporations. So just throwing some thoughts out there on how things can do. Like, it can be GPL with the social consensus of ShareDrop, for example, is one way of applying peer pressure. That we used to be main with the ShareDrop consensus, that same kind of concept of social pressure and just expectations does that. Even when we were public domain, there were a few people that copied the code and tried to launch coins, and they never went anywhere. So I wouldn't say I'm against it. Sorry, lost my train of thought there. But anyway, putting under the GPL is a way of being able to claim we're open source, and it allows freedom of innovation. It also minimizes liability, maximizes decentralization, and still allows us to profit. I think that's overall a relatively good approach. We have a worker proposal in place to open source the GUI code, which is currently licensed only for personal use, but to completely open source it. That worker proposal basically just covers some of our costs and allows us to not charge our partners like OpenLedger a licensing fee. They can keep all of the referral income for it. We just get the one-time payout. End result is maximizing the profitability of these services like Bitcash and OpenLedger and the others, allowing new services to start up and therefore maximizing growth of the ecosystem. So we would be trading a fixed payout, a smaller fixed payout today, for giving those entities greater long-term incentives and maximizing the growth of the ecosystem. We'll probably have that worker proposal for open sourcing that come out and make it available under various licenses, BSD for BitShares, GPL for everyone else, and private blockchains can license other licenses from us. Really trying to grow the BitShares ecosystem, make sure that Cryptonomics is not a bottleneck or seen as being a centralized controlling entity over the project. I really want this to be a decentralized community effort, because that's what's going to allow it to grow.
If you were to reorient or re-release graphene under GPL, does that actually make it easier than simpler for us to swap interchange code in between our like sister chains, such as Muse and potentially Identibit or Play?
Yes, it does, if they are also GPL. Now, keep in mind, we have a contributors agreement that anyone who's contributing code to the project has to license it under a BSD-style license before we will include it in the project. So anything written by other people is completely free for use by BitShares and others. And Cryptonomics can then use it to also profit privately. But we make our stuff GPL, which means as long as you keep yours open, you're fine. So if you only release yours under GPL, we won't accept it into the core of Graphene. Then we'd have to GPL all of Graphene, and we'd lose control over the license.
What's brought on this idea about moving to GPL? I mean, this is something I'm sure you've thought of in the process of even formulating Graphene and the approach to take with it in the market.
Yeah, I think it's just a matter of seeing the feedback, and I've been getting from various places of little complaints here and there about the license resulting in people not wanting to adopt. And I don't want to have easy criticism of being closed source and proprietary. So I think that's what it comes down to, is do we have a business model that depends upon us having super tight control? So as we've evolving our business model, we can open up a little bit more. So I think it really had to do with we were uncertain what we would need to profit earlier. And as we get more certain, we can let go a little bit more, because we recognize that that's not something that we need to be viable as a business.
That's great. Thanks.
Zacato, I'd like to ask for him. He says,
bond markets seem like an important piece to bring in utility and liquidity to BitShares. However, Dan has mentioned in the past this might not be as simple to implement as we think. Could you give us a more detailed explanation on the obstacles we have to face to create bond markets? Do you have any idea on how to solve any of these problems? Are you planning on developing any of these features anytime soon? And you'd probably have big support from the community because of all the positive things that bond markets bring.
First of all, our plans are directly tied to what people are willing to pay for, prioritization-wise. Bond markets are a significant project, both in terms of user interface work, which is the most costly part of it, but also in terms of the back-end blockchain logic required to implement the bond market. It's a non-trivial problem. But even once you've solved all the technical problems, the biggest challenge with bond markets on a blockchain is everything is public, which means all the margin call and liquidation prices are known, which means savvy whales can pre-calculate the effect of a particular move that they would make in the market that would cause people to be liquidated, have to sell at a bad price, and the whales would be there ready to capture that almost instantaneously, right? They can construct a transaction or two that know exactly what the blockchain is going to do, no delays, they can lock in the profits. Make understanding the consequences of an environment where all traders know that, hey, it's an open game. If you're big enough, you can get margin called at unfavorable prices. I think that's probably the single biggest challenge. And it would require, the centralized exchanges don't have that problem because the only person that can manipulate is the exchange itself. And if they're caught doing that, trades will go elsewhere. Which means that most other people have to guess where positions are, and that means that it's not a sure thing. Not being a sure thing means profit margins aren't where they are, so that type of manipulation is less likely to happen. People still try it, but it's a gamble. It wouldn't necessarily be as big of a gamble if everything was public. I haven't done a thorough analysis of what trading strategies would be possible if all information was actually public. But the only thing I can think of is if you introduce some kind of delay between when a margin call is triggered and when it's executed. So we detect that we need to do a margin call. No one can cancel any orders, but people can still place orders on one side of the book that would fill the margin call. Something like that would be a possible solution so that people can have like dark pools of money that when they see a margin call happen, they place the orders to catch it, which means the attacker can't get a guaranteed good price because they don't know where the bots are that are ready to jump on providing liquidity in the event of a margin call. That's the main challenge there. It's really a market trading manipulation, keeping that all fair when everything's public. It might be the case that we can just accept those are the rules of the game. Everyone can play by it. And if you're using margin, that's the risk you take. But yeah, it's entirely possible to ensure that everyone who is lending money can at the very least get all of their principal back, even if they don't get their interest. But we can guarantee the principal trivially. And that means there could be a boom in lending. So it's a big project in terms of user interface, I'm sure that's right, and so forth. So it's the testing required to do on anything that involves the markets is also tremendous because it's not easy to fix mistakes with the markets because properties changed hands and then people can transfer it and then goes to exchanges. And basically, once the exchange does something, it's pretty much irreversible from a retroactive hard fork fix. Lots of testing has to go into that. So I'd say it's a really big project to implement properly. Probably twice that of confidential transactions. So maybe $100,000 project to it's something like that in place.
Thank you. And then there's one more question, and I have to apologize to those who haven't had their question asked. It's sometimes kind of difficult. I don't want to interrupt when we're on a thought process or a topic that seems very important to the community, and sometimes that's just how this rolls. However, there is one more question that seems everybody would like me to ask, and it's from Funny Bear. I think Bytemaster needs to explain how he intended to motivate exchanges to share order books. Through shared IOUs or by asking multiple exchanges to focus on a particular bid asset? From what I see, the dream is not going to become a reality if we keep taking the current route. We'll just end up having a bunch of illiquid IOUs.
It's a real challenge. It's like outsourcing your servers for your order book. Right now, it's like startup exchanges. They can create user-issued assets and run our deposit withdrawal bots from BlockTrades and have an exchange up and running and start making money. But it's still a quote-unquote centralized exchange with a public book that has instantaneous interoperability with the other exchanges in terms of you can trade between the markets with no delays, so it's good for arbitrage. So any exchange that's interested in the arbitrage with exchanges benefits by being on the blockchain. But there are lots and lots of small markets that are as illiquid as any centralized exchange. To incentivize exchanges further, they have, by referring users to BitShares as a whole, they make money from anything the user does once they're on the BitShares platform. So they get like two for one. They advertise users for their exchange, and they are simultaneously advertising users for BitShares, which means they might come into BitShares through some small exchange, migrate over to the more liquid markets and some bigger exchange, but even if they're trading on the bigger exchange, they still brought the user to BitShares, and they still profit. So there's that aspect of the referral program. And then to have everyone focus on being bridges to one asset, that's really just a business decision. The asset that gains the most liquidity is the one that can have the lowest spreads, the most effective bridge candidate. And the exchanges are charging a percentage commission on the bridge process. So the market will naturally want to center on bridging to a particular bit asset. And we don't really have to do anything there. The only other way to incentivize exchanges is to give them an equity stake in BitShares. But that's really hard to do fairly for everyone.
Certainly. Well, thank you for your answers, and thank you everybody for attending.